Yes, hello. Hello everyone and a very good evening. As you all know, we are facing this COVID-19 pandemic, and which has engulfed the entire world. As homeopaths, we thought that we are indebted to the homeopathic fraternity and to humanity as a whole. So as a humble contribution from our part which we can pay to the homeopathic fraternity, we shall discuss about the guidelines issued by our master Dr.Hahnemann towards the finding of genus epidemicus, which is the homeopathic equivalent of a prophylactic and a preventive medicine. To discuss these points with me, I have today Dr.Pravin Deshmukh Sir with me. I am very glad to introduce him. Dr.Pravin Deshmukh Sir is one of those homeopaths who has been our inspiration to read the original writings of Dr.Hahnemann. So I am very glad to introduce him. Dr.Pravin Sir, it's over to you.
Thanks, Dr. Satyajit. First of all, I want to say two things. I am thankful to you for giving me such opportunity. And this is my first time to speak in English. So I am sorry that I will make a lot of grammatical mistake. But our master has said, dare to be wise. I think now it's time to dare to be wise. I think there are a lot of time Dr. Hahnemann has mentioned about the epidemics, not only in Organon but also in theory of chronic disease, and also in lesser writings by Dr. Samuel Hahnemann. All people related to the homeopathy, we know that he mentioned about the how to take the case in epidemic disease in Organon, aphorism number 100, 101 and 102. Simply, he said that you have to examine one, two, different patients, and from that you have to select the remedy. But for selecting the remedy, he gave the exact guideline in 102 aphorism. In 102 aphorism, he said that in the course of writing down the symptoms, several cases of a kind, the sketch of the disease picture become ever more and more complete. From this sentence, you want to say, you have to see the more and more cases of epidemic. Not more spun out and verbose, but more significant, more characteristic, include more of the peculiarities of the collective symptom on one hand. He said that you have to take the peculiar symptoms on one hand, on other hand, general symptoms, example, loss of appetite and sleeplessness. And in this aphorism, he want to say that you have to take the two things, first the particulars of that disease and the general symptoms. If his appetite is any particular, or in his sleep, or in stools, or in his urine, if there is anything particular, we have to pick up and select the remedies. Not only in this Organon, in 100, 101 and 102, there are so many aphorisms he also mentioned about the epidemic disease. I think we will go in intermittent fever. In intermittent fever, he also mentioned a lot of about the epidemic disease.
From my student days, I have been hearing that homeopathy was very successful in the cholera epidemic, in the typhus epidemic. So where exactly in Organon do we find these references?
Not only in basic aphorisms of the case taking, but also in, there are so many aphorisms in which Hahnemann mentioned about the epidemic. I think we will go in 235, we mentioned that with regard to the intermittent fevers that prevails sporadically or epidemically, we often find the every paroxysmus likewise composed of two opposite alternate state, cold heat, heat cold, more frequently still of the three, and therefore the remedy selected for there from general cross class of the crude, common and not antisuric. In this aphorism, he mentioned about the non-antisurics. I don't know exactly the how is the fever of the corona, because we not directly see any patient of the corona. But what he say previous about the previous epidemic, he said that you have to select the medicine common, not antisuric. But the big question is, people not discuss about the what are the antisuric medicines and not what are the non-antisuric medicines. Because in 235, he clearly mentioned that remedy selected for them from general class food, common, not antisuric. I think this is not a time to discuss what is antisuric, not what is not antisuric. Just in single line, I want to explain. Hahnemann says that those remedies we are able to cure the sora. So he gave the name then antisuric. Non-antisuric remedies are, there are a lot of non-antisuric remedies like aconite, bryonia, belladonna, nux vomica, ignatia. These are non-antisuric remedies, and he want to say give non-antisomatic remedy in 235. And one more important thing in 235 in the last part of that aphorism, but the symptoms of the patient's health during the interval when he is free from fever must the chief guide for the most appropriate homeopathic remedy.
So just now you mentioned about non-antisomatic remedies. Where can we find the list of non-antisomatic
remedies? Okay, just simple thing. There are two basic remedies, repertories published by Dr. Boenninghausen. The repertories of the drugs which are antisorics, antipsychotic and antisyphilitic. In that repertory, he mentioned only Merck-Sol 1 antisyphilitic and Thujan nitric acid 2 antipsychotic. Rest of medicines are antisorics. And in non-repertory of the remedies which are non-antisoric, but one medicine is common in both repertory, that is arsenic album. And why it is common in both repertory, I don't know. But I think from 235, he want to say that you have to select the remedy in such epidemic. And which type of epidemic, which 235 explain us. I don't know exactly the corona, how fever was the corona, is the corona. But he said that the patient symptoms, when he is free from the fever, you must have to pick up. And one more important thing, in that footnote, he mentioned that in footnote number of 129, Dr. Hahnemann says, Dr. von Boenninghausen, who has rendered more service to our beneficent system of medicine than any other of my disciples, is best elucidated the subject which demands so much care and has facilitated the choice of efficient remedy to the various epidemic fever in his work.
So where can we find this work? Can we retrieve it from the internet or somewhere else?
Just I take it from PDF file from the internet, and I think this is a very good work by Dr. Respected Dr. Boenninghausen, and he mentioned exactly, very simply he gave the how to select the remedy in epidemic disease and also in regular fevers. This is a very useful book, but I think this book is not available, but just for public interest I want to show this in camera. Just this is the book which I collect in PDF form. And
is it in English or German?
No, this is the translation. This is the translation, some doctor made it translation, and his name is Dr. Boenninghausen's essay on the homeopathic treatment of intermittent fever. In this first part, he gives the materia medica of the remedies, and also he gives very simple chapters. He gives the chapters like the before the fevers. He will collect the lot of symptoms before the symptom, and very few remedies related to that. Just for example, I want to demonstrate one. Before the fever, he gives the like chilliness or diarrhea or drowsiness or pain in abdomen or pain in back, and he gives the only two three remedies, and then second stage is during the fever, and same type of symptom we have to collect during the fever. This is a simple chapter, and then during the chills, he also mentioned if there is a chill in epidemic fever, we can also select the remedies from this. If not only the chills, but also he also mentioned the during the heat and during the sweat. And one point he also made, also mentioned that about the thirst, how is thirst and thirstless. And more important, what Hahnemann is said in aphorism number 235, the interval between two fevers, and when there is a just in simple language, patient is free from fever. At that time, the mental symptoms and physical symptoms are very important for the selection of remedy. And he gave that chapter, I think no one has mentioned as the literature, I know. I don't know if someone has mentioned about that. But I think only Boenninghausen has mentioned the remedies which come only during the symptom of apyrexia.
Okay, it clears one more confusion regarding the importance of mind, whether Boenninghausen gives it or not. That point is also emphasized. So many a times we see that certain things are not described in very detail in the Organon itself, but they might be found in the lesser writings or chronic diseases. Has Dr. Hahnemann written something about epidemics in lesser writings or chronic diseases?
Not only, he also mentioned not only in Organon, he also mentioned in lesser writing and chronic disease. I think this is the very beginning chapter of the chronic disease. I am just going to read. we give an example, the epidemic which come in 1813. This is the in the year of 1813, one patient would be prostrated with only few symptoms of this plague, that he is saying about the plague. Second patient showed only few but different ailments, while the third, fourth and would complain of the other ailments belonging to this epidemic disease. While they were not less all sick with a one and the same pestilential fever, and the entire and the complete image of the typhus fever regaining at the time could only be obtained by gathering together the all or the at least many of these patients, and then one or two remedies found to be homeopathic healed to the whole epidemic. And he gave the example that in that typhus of 1813, bryonia and rustox were the specific remedies for these patients. I think he also mentioned in that 100-102, he collect the symptoms from lot of patients, and collecting that symptoms, we have to make the selection of one or two remedies. And one interesting thing, I think this is not law, but bryonia and rustox, both are non-antiseptic remedies. Here is one example that he also mentioned in, I think in Organon, about the cholera epidemic. In cholera epidemic, I think he divided in two parts. In the when patient is suffering from beginning symptoms, he just advised to give the camphor. And I think he said that if one patient suffering from cholera in the beginning stage, and he advised to give all other family members very small dose of camphor. But in very serious condition or in last condition, in particularly same epidemic of the cholera, he advised to give the cupra.
Did he specify the potency and doses?
He said that give in very low potency. Yeah, so many times, and he also, we have to discuss a lot about that potency, but he mentioned to give in water doses. I think we have to go and read that chapter very details.
What doses has you mean?
Here, I think just all these references are from
divided doses.
Divided doses, or if we are considering the 6th edition, I think he is mentioning about the LM potency. But that is we have to go in further in details. Just this is we have superficial symptoms what we find in our theory of chronic disease and organ.
If a person is suffering from a skin disease, for example, he is suffering from psoriasis and he has been benefited by homeopathy, but in this course of time he is now inflicted with the epidemic disease, whatsoever it is. So what would be the line of treatment? Do we need to change the remedy? Do we need to shift to an acute remedy? Or does the remedy need to be in relation with that chronic remedy? Or as a beginner or as a young practitioner, I am confused. So what would be the guideline?
In theory of chronic disease, chapter 16, Dr. Hahnemann has mentioned this clearly. Just I want to read from, this is the from theory of chronic disease, chapter 16. But during the treatment of chronic disease by antipsoriatic remedies, just he also mentioned every time when you are treating the chronic disease, he also mentioned antipsoriatic, so not simply the remedy or yeah something. But during the treatment of chronic disease by antipsoriatic remedies, we often need the other non-antipsoriatic remedies, store of medicine in case where the epidemic disease or intermediate disease arising usually from meteoric or telluric cause attack our chronic patient, and so not only the temporarily disturb the treatment but even interrupt for the longer time. Here the other homeopathic remedy we have to use, therefore I shall, and just he said that you have to stop that remedy. But all these I think this jo all references are related to the 6th edition, and so he always mentioned about the LM potency. If you are giving in psoriasis patient LM potency regularly, he said that stop that LM potency and select new non-antipsoriatic remedy. He not simply said give any remedy, he said non-antipsoriatic remedy and start your treatment of the epidemic disease or intermediate disease.
And what is the reason for especially mentioning a non-antipsoriatic remedy in epidemic disease? Is it because not interrupting the action of the antipsoriatic remedy which the patient is taking for his chronic disease, or is it according to the guidelines for the treatment of epidemic disease?
He said that in Boenninghausen reported there is a page number 185. In 185 page number Boenninghausen, he divided the remedies in 5 parts. part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, part 5. In first part, he gave the remedies, I just remember, Iconet. And he said that this is the remedy which act very rapidly. And you must have to use in only as an intermediate remedy in chronic cases. And also in second chapter, you also mentioned the all remedies in second column use all are non-antisuri, and they are he is that this is a brief action. I think that we have very short time in epidemic disease, and so we want to recover our patient. So I think he mentioned that you have to use the non-antisuri remedy, but he mentioned one thing. So many times if the fever is recovered and patients some symptoms are remaining and same fever is frequently coming, if he is not living in marshy places, he also mentioned one thing. If some one person is remaining in marshy places and he frequently suffering from the fever, he said that you have to remove him from marshy places and give him the dose of Simbona. But he is doing all things better and repeatedly suffering from same fever, then in that case you have to select the remedy antisuri. Because the soramycin is in background, so he is not going to cure. But for that that thing, we must have to clear the knowledge which remedies are antisuri and which are non-antisuri. I think this chapter, I don't know why people are not discussing about these topics. Next time we will definitely discuss about that.
So my next question is in continuation with the previous one. We were talking about a psoriasis patient. He was inflicted with this epidemic. Now he's free from the epidemic disease. Now what should be the line of treatment? Shall we resume the remedy which we were using for his psoriasis, or shall be the line?
Yeah. He mentioned that due to that this epidemic disease, that is the burst of latent psora. So he mentioned that so many times the symptoms of that previous chronic disease are altered. They are sometimes changed, or they may give new pictures. He said that we have to selecting the remedy for that chronic patient. We now have to collect all the symptoms and select the new remedy. Or maybe old remedy may come, but some symptoms are changed. Or so many times he mentioned in the things I am going to read. So many times part of the body is affected, and we have to pick up that symptom and select the new remedy, not just simply or blindly give the old remedy as mentioned not by me but by Dr. Samuel Hahnemann in theory of chronic disease.
From bias and hoodism, and we need to reassess the case. Is it?
Yes.
Before moving on to the next question, so is there anything which we need to consider regarding the treatment of epidemics on a superimposed chronic case?
He also mentioned one thing. I think we all homeopathic friends must have to discuss that point. He mentioned that, please hear carefully, even at the beginning of the treatment of epidemic intermittent fever, the homeopathic physician is the most safe in give every time an attenuated dose of sulfur, or in appropriate cases, keeper sulf in a fine little pellet or by means of smelling, and in waiting its effect for a few days until the improvement results from CSS, and then only he will give in one or two attenuated dose of, once again, non-antisoric medicine which has been found homeopathically appropriate to the epidemic of this year. This also mentioned that here, but I think we have to discuss details about this chapter, these things. Here I mentioned in Sora chapter in theory of chronic disease, he start with sulfur and wait for few times, or he also mentioned few days, and so many days if patient is improving, and if the once improvement stop, you have to select the another non-antisoric remedy. He clearly mentioned once again non-antisoric remedy.
Okay. So for further reading, what chapters from the organ or from the chronic disease or from the lesser writings do you recommend?
I think definitely we have find lot of things in Organon and in theory of chronic disease, but few things which I find in lesser writing by Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, there are a lot of things he mentioned in lesser writing. I think we have not sufficient time to discuss that things, but I want to just mention the chapter's name, what he said that. I think first chapter is protection against the infection in epidemic disease. I think this is very useful for general public and practitioner also. another chapter in same book, suggestion for the prevention of epidemic in general, especially in towns. Now another chapter is cure and prevention of scarlet fever. I think he mentioned scarlet fever. I think he is mentioned about belladonna in scarlet fever. He said that in Organon, we missed that aphorism or footnote. He mentioned that in that scarlet fever, belladonna was not only curative but also preventive medicine. He also mentioned very clearly cure and prevention of scarlet fever. And another chapter in lesser writing by Dr. Samuel Hahnemann on the prevalence of fever. And another chapter is treatment of typhus or hospital fever at the present prevailing. The treatment of purpura miliaris. Next chapter is cause and prevention of the Asiatic cholera. And the, I think last chapter is the mode of propagation of the Asiatic cholera. And I think just I want to mention about, I do not know exactly the detailed pictures of the corona, but he mentioned that that intermittent fever every time comes with different symptoms. And so every year we have to select the new remedy, just not ki last year we are cured that present with the X medicine, same year you have to give X. No, he said that every year fever will come with a change symptom.
So this is again very relevant as regards homeopathy also. We have been like imbibing in our minds to be free from prejudice, and again considering the characteristics of any virus, it has been observed that the coronavirus has mutated at least 2 times. It is quite likely that we can see further mutations also. So again, this point needs to be emphasized.
I think this is the genius of our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann. So many centuries back, he know the how epidemics in futures are coming. And this is the genius and this is the magic of our
optic. Or maybe this is the foresight that he had, which is still, which makes his science and art immortal in the real sense.
And one more thing, equipment, when the present day, they are detecting the virus. And that man with the limited knowledge, limited sources, and he gives us such a things which are useful for present days.
Okay sir, as we have seen, you have told us this is the proper approach given by our master in fighting the Genus epidemicus. But are there any references, are there any documented success about this approach to earlier epidemics?
Yeah, he mentioned in Organon in footnote number 72, in 1801, one first epidemic come purpura miliaris. In that epidemic he used I think aconite, and suddenly after a few months second epidemic come, that is scarlet fever. In that epidemic he used belladonna, and combination of these two, again third epidemic come, but he not use first aconite or belladonna in that cases, but in third epidemic he used new medicine. He mentioned in footnote number 72.
As we can see, what our master tells, he practices it himself. So that is why his words carry so much importance. And as we have seen, those are immortal works. So is it anything more interesting, anything worth sharing which we missed, but we shall share it now?
Yeah, one footnote of Organon, 17 number footnote. He mentioned how homeopathy can prevent the prevalence of the epidemic. He mentioned, I read very small footnote. A striking fact in corroboration with this, that whilst the previously to this year 1801, when the smooth scarlatina of the Sydenham still occasionally prevailed epidemically among the children, it attacked without exception all the children who had accepted it in the former epidemic, in a similar epidemic which I witnessed. On contrary, all the children, I think this is very important point, all the children who took in the time a very small dose of belladonna remained unaffected by this highly infectious infantile disease. If medicine can protect from the disease that is raging around, they must possess a vastly a superior power of affecting our vital force.
He clearly mentioned that belladonna is preventive in that it is 01 epidemicus. So as they say that it is almost impossible to learn homeopathy without a master, without a teacher. To gain a very sound understanding of any art or science, it is very essential that we grasp the understanding of the source books, the original writings of the propounders of that school. And this is the commonest mistake which we do. We read everything, but we fail to read Organon itself, the chronic diseases and the lesser writings. The least we can do is abide to and take guidance of those individuals, as they say in Hindi, jo in literature ko ghol ke pi gaye, aise logo se to hum zarur uska guidance le sakte. The least we can do is take guidance of those teachers who are genuinely interested in original work and those who have simplified something for us. This is the least thing which we can do. It is very essential we do not forget our source books, otherwise we will lose our paths. If this message can be spread, I think we have fulfilled our motive behind conducting this interview. And I am again thankful to Dr. Pravin Deshmukh Sir. This was a humble contribution in the ongoing pandemic which has sent havoc over the entire globe. If you like this interview, please like, share and subscribe. And any in case of any doubt, all the queries are welcome, and spread this as far as possible. Thank you so much.